I welcome everyone to this presentation that I entitled The Message of the Star by the Three Wise Men to Seventh-day Adventists. Herod believed the Magi, and he fulfilled prophecy. Do we believe it? Well, the wise man had seen a mysterious light in the heavens. As the light faded, a luminous star appeared and lingered in the sky. It was not a fixed star nor a planet, and the phenomenon excited the keenest interest. That star was a distant company of shining angels, but the wise men were ignorant of this. Yet they were impressed that the star was of special import to them. Before we study this message further, let us seek the Lord to guide us into this with His Holy Spirit. Lord, there's no new thing under the sun, you've said, and that which has been is now, and that which is to be has already been. And that's why you say you require that which is past. So let us understand what happened in the past, Lord, through the help of your Holy Spirit, and put it into practice in our lives. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the three wise men consulted priests and philosophers. They searched the scrolls of the ancient records. The prophecy of Balaam they found, and it declared, "There shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel." Could this strange star have been sent as a harbinger of the Promised One? What is a harbinger? Well, in England, it is an officer of the king's household who rides a day's journey before the court when traveling to provide lodging or other accommodations. He's a forerunner, a precursor. And he precedes and gives notice of an expected arrival. The three wise men all had a dream, and they decided to follow that dream to understand what's behind it. And as the star directed them to go to Israel, they realized when they came to Israel that the star actually was resting above the temple. And of course, that fit. The new prince, of course, would be in the capital. And so they arrived there, but there was no real interest in that newborn prince. No one knew about it. They searched and searched and could not find any help. Well, but Herod, he heard about it, and he called them privately. And he inquired diligently of what was behind that star. And he told them, "Well, wait, I'll find out more for you." So he stepped on the feet of the wise men of the Jewish nation to give him more information. And then he sent them to Bethlehem. And lo and behold, when they went on their trip to Bethlehem, at night, in the evening, they saw the star again, and they rejoiced greatly. And when they arrived, they worshipped that newborn king and presented to that king their gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Well, what they didn't realize before, but found out when they talked to Mary and Joseph, Mary and Joseph actually were, at the time when they saw the star, in Jerusalem. But they could not present any treasures because they were poor. For their cleansing, Mary offered only two turtle doves. She would have loved to offer a lamb and give other treasures, but it wasn't given to them. Well, The wise men found out about some of the rites that the Jewish nation were accustomed to, and so 8 days after the birth of Jesus, he was circumcised, and Mary had to continue in her purification for another, till the 40th day, and that's when she was in Jerusalem, and the wise men saw the star over the temple. Well, all these Jewish customs were of interest to the wise men, the circumcision, the purification on the 40th day. And actually, Mary and Joseph were able to explain to them many things about relating to the 40 days. When God cleansed the earth during the time of Noah, it rained for 40 days on the ark. When Moses appeared before God, he cleansed himself once for himself and once for the whole nation with fasting, neither eating or drinking. When the 12 spies returned after 40 days to Canaan, God tested his people to see if they had faith, but he did not find faith, and they had to travel through the desert for another 40 years. When Goliath presented himself before David, it was on the 40th day that David actually came and slew him. Elijah also fasted 40 days. Jesus did it, and afterwards he was tested. The Ninevites were tested after 40 days. Could the 40-day test be also for us as his people? As much as Joseph and Mary told them about the Jewish customs, they also were quite surprised about the visit, and they inquired also how come that they appeared in Bethlehem. So the wise men told them about the journey and how they had seen the star and how it appeared about 2 years actually before the event, they realized. And that's what they shared with Herod. And that's why Herod killed all the children 2 years old and under, in order to make sure to eradicate the newborn king. Well, they inquired also about the birth of Jesus and found out that there was a harbinger for the birth of Jesus, which was John the Baptist. And all of these things happened in the meantime, but they were the first ones to receive notice. After the wise men had inquired all the things of interest to them, they decided to go back, and they wanted to go back via Jerusalem, as they had promised to Herod. But that night before, they all had a dream that they should not go that way. And after they departed that night, the following night, Joseph had a dream, and it told him to arise and to take the young child and his mother and to flee into Egypt, because Herod would seek to destroy the child. And that same night, Herod departed, and that following day, the doom broke out over Bethlehem, as the prophet Isaiah had prophesied. Well, so we look at the timeline of the events of Christ's first coming. 2 years before the birth, there was an announcement with the star to the wise men. He was born, I say, day one. The 8th day he was circumcised. The 40th day he was dedicated in the temple in Jerusalem. Then, a few days later, the wise men gave gifts to the child, and a few days after that, a massacre started. Do we know when all these things happened? On day 40, when they were in Jerusalem, there was their big disappointment. They realized that their The message they brought them found now did not find any interest, and the message was rejected. We find a similar situation in the life of Christ. John the Baptist, he preached repentance, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And Christ came there, and a voice witnessed his divinity. At the following Passover, Christ claimed to be actually the Messiah when cleansing the temple. And a year later, after healing, the Jews thought to kill him. They rejected their Messiah. The following year, he decided not to go to Jerusalem for the Passover, and he stayed in Galilee, knowing that they would attempt to kill him. And even Galilee, he was at the end rejected. And on the fourth Passover in 31 AD, his crisis began. Christ was crucified. Well, Christ knew the day of his visitation. Do we know our day of visitation? It says in Isaiah 10, "What will ye do in the day of visitation and in the desolation which shall come from far? To whom will ye flee for help?" And the visitation means afflictions, calamities, judgments. And we read in the great controversy that Daniel even had specified the time of the advent of Christ. And the Jewish leaders, they were without an excuse. It was a sinful neglect not to study the message. And then we read, "Oh, what a lesson is this wonderful story of Bethlehem. How it rebukes our unbelief, our pride and self-sufficiency. How it warns us to beware, lest by our criminal indifference we also fail to discern the signs of the times and therefore know not the day of our visitation." So, in other words, by studying the word, we will know the day of our visitation. Well, I showed you before in the Seven Thunders, which I found in the sanctuary message, the time of our visitation. And the final universal death decree, just before the time when Christ will come back, when the Father will announce the day and the hour of Christ's coming, we find portrayed actually in the decree by Ahasuerus. And there was a clear day and time given for that death decree. And when Christ talked about the time of the end, he said, yeah, we will not know the day and hour, but it will be as in the days of Noah. And let's see what Noah preached. It says, "The faithful preacher of righteousness declared the message to the inhabitants that 120 years would be the end of their probation." And another citation, "Noah preached to the people of his time that God would give them 120 years in which to repent of their sins and find refuge in the ark. But their unbelief did not hinder the predicted event." That's why I believe we have to study what happened in the past, because God requires that which is past of us. There was the 490-year prophecy cut off for the Jews from the 2,300-year prophecy. And in that last week, Christ's death in 31 AD, marked the middle of the last week. And with that, that prophecy ended with the stoning of Stephen, 34 AD. There was a 7-year warning period before Jerusalem's destruction, starting in 63 and ending in 70 AD, with the sign for the flight being in the middle of that time in 64 AD. Well, we read that a day star should arise in our hearts. And this day star I applied. This day star I applied to the sanctuary message. And I can show you here 7 thunders that give a delineation of end time events. But this delineation is not just without time. The first event was when the Abomination of Desolation was standing in 2015 in America and the Day of Atonement in front of the Congress and preaching also to the United Nations. And when we apply this as a starting point for the final judgment, we expected a crisis in spring of 2015 and the end in the fall of 2022. There's a prophecy actually attached to the end that was spoken in 1906. In 1906, Ellen White wrote, "When Christ comes, he takes those who have purified their souls by obeying the truth. Some will go into the grave who are now in active life, and some will be alive and be changed when Christ shall come. To all who follow his example in his life in this world, he has given power to become the sons of God." Well, 1906 to 2021, that brings us to an age of 115. And there was actually a report forwarded to me about some lady called Francisca Susano. She lives in the Philippines and she's now 123 years old. And her family submitted documents to the Guinness Book of World Records to prove that she is the oldest, seems to be the oldest living person today. The current person is now at least 117 years old, and he's a Japanese person. Well, if Christ wants to come back in 2022 and these people are still supposed to be alive, it has to happen soon. It cannot tarry another 100 of years, like some people say. Well, God gave us the day star for this, not the star for the Magi. The day star opened for me the prophecy to the 7 thunders, and I encourage everyone to study this. But as we are now in the judgment of the living, as I believe, the second coming had been announced. The crisis was expected in 2019, but did not come. But retrospectively, we see that even the delay was predicted. Because in Habakkuk we read, "Write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the time it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry, so at the end it will fulfill itself." So this delay is just God's mercy to his royal priesthood. The sad thing is, just like the 3 Magi were disappointed, the message was rejected by the majority of the people they met in Jerusalem. And that rejection happened on the 40th day. So the 40th day seems to be a test day. Well, What happens after day 40? There is, I put in here already day 50 for the gifts and day 55 for the massacre. And I show you how I came up with this, among others. We have this spring festivals, and the first day is the waving of the first fruits, and that's the wave sheaf ceremony. The 50th day, so 49 days later after that, comes the Feast of Weeks, where two leavened breads are waved in the sanctuary. And leavened breads, leaven is sin, so these are not the ones without sin, but people with sin that are waved in a sense before God in the sanctuary. But there are fall feasts, and they are related to the grape harvest, which typically ends before the Feast of Tabernacles. And these feasts, the Feast of Trumpets, Day of Atonement, and Feast of Tabernacles, they have their specific time in the seventh month. And we read in Joel 2:23 that at the end, He will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. So the former rain came once, the early rain, which was in 34 AD. But at the end, we will have the former and latter rain join each other in the first month. Normally, the Feast of Pentecost is in the third agricultural month. So that brings us to June, maybe, yeah? But in this case, there will be an exception, we understand. And we also read in Amos about a very interesting Bible verse in 9:13. Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that the plowman shall overtake the reaper, and the treader of grapes him that sows seed. So that means that actually the plowing will happen before the harvest is finished, it seems like, or the grapes are being tread before this new seed is being sown. So it seems like an overlapping of the spring festivals with the fall festivals. And we find an interesting statement in early writings in regards to this. The Holy Spirit, in the middle of the paragraph, the Holy Spirit was descended on the day of Pentecost, carried the minds of the disciples from the earthly sanctuary to the heavenly, where Jesus had entered by his own blood, to shed upon his disciples the benefit of his atonement. So here, the Feast of Pentecost is brought in conjunction or joined with the Feast of Atonement. So when we put the festivals together, we have day one, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, day 40, which actually is also the day of the Ascension of Christ. We have in between as a decision-making point. Then comes day 50, where the wheat harvest is actually started on the day of Pentecost. And that's joined with the Day of Atonement. So day 50 and day 10 of the seventh month fall together. And 5 days after the Day of Atonement, there's a Feast of Tabernacles, when people dwell in tents. And in that sense, dwelling in tents is when you are on the run, when you are, for example, persecuted. So the spring festival, actually, the Day of Unleavened Bread, in my understanding of the Seven Thunders, represents the national sun law. And the following represents the day 40 will be the day when the new world order will be established. Day 50 will then be the outpouring of the latter rain, with that the loud cry, and the new laws of the new world order will be given that day. And on the day 55, the universal Sunday law will then be enforced, which will have been given before. We find the same timeline this way in the events related to Christ's first coming, the 2 years before the birth, the day of birth. Here the circumcision is included on the day 8, the 40th day, the time of the dedication, and that was the day when Jerusalem missed the newborn king, the promised Messiah, even though he was there being dedicated. And then day 50, the day when the wise men presented their gifts to the newborn babe, and day 55 with a massacre. And the rejection of the leadership and of the majority of the Jews of Christ happened in the life of Christ also, 2 years before the final crisis. So if you apply this now to the time of the judgment of the living, God's testing of the barley through his delay, we have the spring of 2019, we have a two-year period that is the testing period, and the time when the loud cry will be given, then the testing period is already over. The testing, the final call for Seventh-day Adventists is now, before the loud cry will be issued. And with that, we can apply now this timelines also to the three thunders that I showed here in this presentation, and that was given through the day star prophecy that I did not explain yet, but that needs to be studied by everyone, I believe. So we have the second thunder with the National Sunday Law on day one, the third thunder, the New World Order on day 40, and the outpouring of the latter rain with the laws given, including the Sunday Law, on the fourth thunder, but the enforcement of the law will be day 55. And just like the people, God's people, when they stood before Canaan the first time, the 12 spies came back on the 40th day, and God made them, or God tested their faith, but they did not have sufficient faith, and they were punished and had to go for another 40 years through the desert. The difference here is, though, that there will not be another delay. Yeah, it is a criminal offense if we, and a sinful neglect, if we don't study the day of our visitation. We read, God does not compel men to give up their unbelief. The human mind is endowed with power to discriminate between right and wrong. God designs that men shall not decide from impulse, but from weight of evidence, carefully comparing scripture with scripture. Had the Jews laid by their prejudice and compared written prophecy with the facts characterizing the life of Jesus, they would have perceived a beautiful harmony between the prophecies and their fulfillment in the life and ministry of the lowly Galilean. And we are standing upon the borders of the greatest event in the world's history. Satan must not have power over the people of God, causing them to sleep on. The papacy will appear in its power. All must now arouse and search the scriptures, for God will make known to his faithful ones what shall be in the last time. The word of the Lord is to come to his people in power. And we read, the time of trouble such as was not since there was a nation, is right upon us. And I believe we can sense this already. And we are like the sleeping virgins. We are to awake and ask the Lord Jesus to place underneath us his everlasting arms and carry us through the time of trial before us. Well, the work of redemption, it's the mystery of mercy. And the subject of the sanctuary was the key which unlocked the mystery of the disappointment in 1884. And we read in the last sentence, light from the sanctuary illuminated the past, the present, and the future. And this is now the light of the day star that she refers to, I believe. We read, those who received the light concerning the sanctuary and the immutability of the law of God were filled with joy and wonder as they saw the beauty and harmony of the system of truth that opened to their understanding. I like to encourage you to search the scriptures if you find it these ways. And I like to encourage you also to subscribe to the channel or to peruse at least the channel to see how this is applied to the seven thunders, that you understand the day star message. I have several recent publications on the seven thunders. The old ones are not all correct. They might be still there. But look at the more recent ones from the last several months. And I encourage you not to believe my word, but to believe in the Lord. And he said, we shall be established if we believe in his prophets. And we should shut our eyes to everything but the present saving truth. And we will realize that God is the master of the situation. And if we follow the light that's given us by the Magi and by the day star prophecy, you will be amazed. May God bless you as you study this. Amen.